Chapter 2, From Trade to Territory in the History. We'll move up as we have completed the first chapter. Now we'll move to the second chapter, From Trade to Territory. Second chapter, Aurangzeb was the last powerful Mughal ruler. He established control over a large part of the territory that is known now as India. After his death in 1707, many Mughal governors, subedars and big zamindars began asserting their authority and establishing regional kingdoms. As powerful regional kingdoms emerged in various parts of India, Delhi could no longer function as an effective center. So what happened? Aurangzeb was the very last and most powerful ruler of the Mughal rulers. But what happened? He established control over a large part of the territory that is now known as India. He was able to rule over a large part of a territory. After his death in 1707, many Mughal governors, subedars and big zamindars began asserting their authority and established regional kingdoms. As powerful regional kingdoms emerged in various parts of India, Delhi could no longer function as an effective center. Delhi was unable to function as an effective center because what happened? Powerful regional kingdoms were emerging. They started emerging because after Aurangzeb, there were no such good powerful ruler who was able to control the entire India. After his death, the Delhi kings became the weak. By the second half of the 18th century, however, a new power was emerging on the political horizon, came as a small trading company and were reluctant to acquire territories. And they were very much reluctant to acquire the territories. So let us see what were they. By the second half of the 8th century, however, a new power was emerging on the political horizon, the British. Did you know that the British originally came as a small trading company and were reluctant to acquire territories? How did these, I already told you, these British people are the cunning people, cunning fox people. They came to India in order to do the trade. They came as the merchants, they wanted to do the trade in India, but what they did? They started ruling the India. So they started small trading company and started to acquire the territories. They started acquiring small kingdoms and they started ruling. How then did they become to be the masters of the vast empire? In this chapter, you will see how this came about. Let us see how this came about. Let us see. East India Company comes east. In 1600, East India Company acquired a charter from the ruler of England, Queen Elizabeth I. So Queen Elizabeth I gave the charter or gave the order, granting it the sole right to trade with the East. This meant to that no other trading group in England could compete with the East India Company. So she gave the charter, right? She gave the order that only East India Company has the rights to trade in India. No other company can do it. With this charter, the company could venture across the oceans looking for new lands from which it could buy goods at cheaper price and carry them back to Europe to sell at higher prices. Here you can see the Europeans, they were purchasing the goods and services for very low prices in India, and they were exporting to England and they were selling in England at a very high prices. For example, if you take a pencil for 2 rupees and if you are selling it for 10 rupees, what is the profit margin? 8 rupees. So like that they were doing. They were taking the crops, they were purchasing the crops at a very low price and they were selling it to the other countries of the Europe with a very higher prices. The company did not have to fear competition from other English trading companies. The company was not having any fear. It was fearlessly working. Did not have any fear with the other trading companies. Mercantile trading companies in those days made profit primarily by excluding competition. There was no competition because Queen Elizabeth I had given the charter that only East India Company is allowed to trade. Right, so mercantile trading companies in those days, it made profit. How much profit? Very huge profit they had made, so that they could buy cheap and sell dear. Dear means as they wish they were selling. They were making huge profits. I told you, you have purchased a pencil for 2 rupees and you are selling it for 10 rupees, 8 rupees you are making as a profit. The Royal Charter, however, could not prevent other European powers from entering the Eastern market. So here you can see the Royal Charter, however, it is not able, it could not prevent other European powers from entering the Eastern markets. It was not able to, the Royal Charter was not allowing them to enter the European markets. By the time the first English ships, sailed down the west coast of Africa around the Cape of Good Hope and crossed the Indian Ocean, the Portuguese had already established their presence in the western coast of India and had their base in Goa. So what happened here? By the time the first English ships had come to India in the west coast of Africa around the Cape of Good Hope and crossed the Indian Ocean, the Portuguese had already their presence in the west coast of India and had their base in Goa. Already the Portuguese were there in Goa before the English could come to India. In fact, it was Vasco da Gama, a Portuguese explorer, who had discovered this sea route to India in the 1498. In the 1498, it was Vasco da Gama who has discovered the sea route to India, and by that sea route, the Portuguese had already entered the India and they were settled in the Goa. In fact, it was Vasco da Gama, a Portuguese explorer, who had discovered the sea route to India in the year 1498. Underline it, very important. Vasco da Gama has discovered the sea route to India in the year 1498. By the early 17th century, the Dutch too were exploring the possibilities of trade in the Indian Ocean. Soon the French traders arrived on the scene. So Dutch were searching, before that the French had come. First, who came to India? Portuguese came, because Vasco da Gama has discovered the sea route to India. Next, the British came to India. After that, what happened? The Dutch were trying every possibility to reach the Indian Ocean. But what happened? French traders came into India. The problem was that all the companies were interested in buying the same things. See, this is the, what we can say, the joke or the comedy. All the people were interested to buy the same things. For example, you all are interested in purchasing the same frock. That time what happens? There is a competition between you all people. I want this, I want this, I want this. Now let us see what happens. The fine qualities of cotton and silk produced in India had a big market in Europe. The fine cotton, I told no, our India is a sone ki chidiya, means golden bird it is. So everyone wanted the fine quality of the silk and cotton which was produced in India. It had the big market in the Europe. Pepper, cloves, cardamom and cinnamon too were in great demand. Where? In the Europe, they were in the great demand. Competition amongst the European companies inevitably pushed up the prices at which these goods could be purchased. So what happened? Because of this competition, the prices of all the spices, cotton, silk was increased. Now what happened? And this reduced the profits that could be earned. So if one company is taking everything, it can make huge profit. Here 3-4 companies are there, 3-4 countries are having competition, the profit is reduced because the profit is shared among the Dutch, among the French, among the British, among the Portuguese. So what happened? The only way the trading companies could flourish was by eliminating rival competitors. So what they thought that if you remove the competitors from the market, then we can make more and more profits. The urge to secure markets therefore led to fierce battles between the trading companies. Through the 17th and 18th centuries, they regularly snagged each other's ships, blocked added routes, and prevented rival ships from moving with the supplies of the goods. Here what they started? They started the battle. They were not giving the sea routes in order to cross. Right, in order to move. They were not allowing the ships to move from one place to the another place. They were blocking the routes. They were blocking the roads. Trade was carried on with arms and trading posts were protected through fortification. They started closing with the arms and they started trading posts. They started the trading post and they were protected through fortification. Like this, these all things were happening. These efforts to fortify settlements and carry on profitable trade also led to intense conflict with local rulers. So what happened? There was an intense conflict between the local rulers when these things were happening. The company therefore found it difficult to separate trade from politics. So what happened here? The company, the East India Company, was finding it very difficult to earn more and more profits because there were intense conflict between all these local rulers as well as with the French, Dutch, as well as with the Portuguese. They were having the politics. They were having the fights. They were having the battles. Okay, East India Company begins trade in Bengal. The first English factory was set up on the banks of the river Hooghly in 1651. This was the base which the company's trader know at that time as factors operated. So they were thinking in the first English factory which was set up on the banks of the river Hooghly in 1651. It was the first factory set up and this was the base for the company's traders known at the time as factors. It means they were settling down there. They had a base where all the traders used to come and they used to rest there. That was called as the factors operated. The factory had a warehouse where goods for export were stored. It was having the warehouse. Warehouse means just like godown where the company which it wants to export the goods and services all were stored in that factory. As trade expanded, the company persuaded merchants and traders to come and settle near the factory. As the trade was expanding, it told the company to come and settle all the merchants nearby the company so that it becomes easy for the transporting the goods and services from one place to the another place. By 1696, it began building a fort around the settlement. Yes, in order to prevent itself from the enemy's attack, it started building the fort against the factory. 2 years later, it bribed Mughal officials into the giving the company zamindari rights over 3 villages. One of these was Calicutta, which later grew into the city of Calcutta or Kolkata as it is known today. So what this British people did, they took the zamindari rights of the Calcutta. It also persuaded the Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb to issue a farman granting the company the right to trade duty free. Here the Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb, what he did, he gave an order the company that they have got the right to trade. Duty free means they will not be given, they need not pay any tax, but they can do the business for free of cost. The company tried continuously to press for more concessions and manipulate existing privileges. The company right to trade duty free, but officials of the company who were carrying on private trade on the side were accepted to pay duty. So the officials who are doing private trade, they have to pay the duty, but other government officials were not allowed to pay the duty. Duty free means they were tax free. This they refused to pay, causing an enormous loss of revenue for Bengal. Right, this made the Bengal in the loss. Now let us see what happened in the next. How could the Nawab of Bengal, Murshid Quli Khan, not protest? So this is a big story. In the next class, I will tell you what all happened. Thank you.